Next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on a COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Nicola Sturgeon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At the outset today, I want to confirm that there will be no changes this week to the COVID levels of protection that currently apply to different parts of the country. I'll say more about that later and also look ahead to the more substantive three-weekly review that I will set out to Parliament a week today, which is as scheduled ahead of the 28th of June, when the next schedule change and a move to level zero for the whole country was expected to take place. Firstly, though, I'll give a general summary of the current course of the pandemic, starting with today's statistics. The total number of cases that were reported yesterday was 974, which is 5% of the total number of tests. That means the overall number of confirmed cases is now 248,515. 137 people are currently in hospital, which is 9 more than the number yesterday, and 17 people are receiving intensive care right now, and that is the same number as reported yesterday. I also regret to say that 2 further deaths were reported yesterday, and that takes the total number of deaths registered under the daily definition to 7,683. And once again, I want to send my condolences to everyone who has been bereaved over the course of the pandemic. I'll also provide an update on the vaccination programme. However, because of a technical issue at Public Health Scotland this morning, I would ask members to note that the figures I am about to give are likely to underreport yesterday's vaccination performance. However, on the basis of the information I do have at this stage, I can confirm that as of 7:30 this morning, 3,531,461 people had received their first dose of the vaccine, which is an increase of 13,793 since yesterday. And in addition, 23,347 people received a second dose yesterday, and that brings the total number of second doses now to 2,470,181. But I would ask people to remember that those figures are likely to underreport the number of vaccinations that were carried out yesterday, and we will update that as quickly as possible. As is clear from the update I've just given on the range of statistics, cases do continue to rise. 6,651 new cases have been reported over the course of the past week, and that compares to a total of 5,475 in the week before that. So cases have risen by more than one-fifth in the past week, and they are now more than 5 times higher than the situation in early May. That reflects the fact that the faster transmitting Delta variant is now common across Scotland and accounts for the overwhelming majority of new cases being reported at that stage. Now, it's important to point out, given the risk, for example, of long COVID, we should never be complacent about a rising curve of infections. However, as I have indicated before, we do hope that vaccination is increasingly protecting people against serious illness. If this is indeed the case, then our experience of this virus will become different and our ability to cope with it in a less restrictive way will become much greater. That's why we continue to very closely monitor the extent to which the rise in new cases is or is not leading to a commensurate rise in the number of people who fall seriously ill and require hospital treatment. Now, our early data on this point is encouraging, and I'll say more about that shortly, but we still do need further analysis, in particular to more fully understand the impact of the Delta variant. To that end, a new study published yesterday by Edinburgh University was instructive, and I would recommend that members read that. On the one hand, it suggests that the Delta variant is associated with a higher risk of hospitalisation than other variants, But on the other hand, it suggests that double dose vaccination continues to provide a high level of protection against infection with and hospitalisation from the virus. This was underlined by another study published yesterday by Public Health England, showing extremely strong protection against hospitalisation after two doses of vaccine. So in short, all of the evidence so far suggests that while it hasn't yet been completely broken, vaccination is weakening the link between the rise in new cases and a rise in hospitalisations and serious illness. So there is much in these studies about the impact of vaccination for us to be optimistic about. And as I indicated earlier, that is reflected in our own hospital data, which of course is published on a daily basis. The number of people being admitted to hospital with COVID has fallen from around 10% of reported positive cases at the start of the year to around 5% now. In addition, since around the start of May, new cases have increased at a much faster rate than hospital admissions. We're also now seeing some evidence that the people who require hospital care are on average younger than during previous stages of the pandemic. In the latest week, for example, the highest number of new admissions was seen amongst people in their 30s and 40s. The next highest number was of people in their 20s. Before the vaccination programme started, people over the age of 50 usually made up the highest number of new admissions to hospital. Now, let me stress, we shouldn't be complacent about hospitalisation for anyone, no matter what age they are. But the fact that more of the recent hospital admissions are in younger age groups may mean that fewer of the people being admitted to hospital are becoming seriously ill or requiring intensive care. And that may also help to explain my next point. Hospital occupancy, which is the total number of people with COVID in hospital at any given time, is not rising at the same rate as either hospital admissions or cases of COVID. Indeed, while there has been an approximate five-fold increase in cases since the start of May, hospital occupancy is around just double what it was at the start of May. What that suggests is that people are being discharged more quickly and spending, on average, less time in hospital than patients were in earlier phases of the pandemic. And again, while that is encouraging, it's important to stress that further analysis is needed to confirm this. Which brings me to the judgments we require to make now and next week. In short, we are hopeful that vaccination is changing the game in our fight against this virus and perhaps in a very fundamental way. But the emerging evidence still does need close analysis. And more fundamentally, and perhaps this is the most fundamental point of all today, we do need time to get more people vaccinated with both doses. In the race between the virus and vaccines that we've spoken about often, we are increasingly confident that vaccines will win that race. But we mustn't allow the virus to get too far ahead of it. The vaccination programme is going exceptionally well. It is being rolled out just as quickly as supplies allow. But there is still a significant proportion of the population that isn't yet fully vaccinated with two doses. And to be blunt, that remains our biggest vulnerability at this stage. And it is quite a significant vulnerability when cases are rising at the pace they are. So we need to buy ourselves sufficient time for the vaccination to get ahead and to stay ahead of the virus. And that is the reason for caution to be exercised at this juncture. Of course, these issues are also being weighed up by the UK government and by the other governments across the UK. And of course, the UK government just yesterday announced a four-week delay to its plans for lifting COVID restrictions in England. The Scottish government too will continue to adopt a cautious approach. I've already confirmed today that no changes will be made this week to the levels that apply in any part of the country. Our next full scheduled review of the protection levels will take place next week, and this will consider whether any changes are possible from the 28th of June onwards, the date when we had hoped we would see the whole country move down to level zero. Now, I will confirm our decision to Parliament next week following that review. However, given the current situation and the need to get more people fully vaccinated before we ease up further, it is reasonable, I think, to indicate now that it is unlikely that any part of the country will move down a level from the 28th of June. Instead, it is more likely that we will opt to maintain restrictions for a further 3 weeks from the 28th of June and use that time to vaccinate with both doses as many more people as possible. Doing that will give us the best chance later in July of getting back on track and restoring the much greater normality that we all crave. To that end, we will also do three other things next week, and I'll report on all of this this time next week when I stand here to give a statement. If our decision is to retain current levels for a further 3 weeks, and we have to go through the proper process to arrive at that decision, but if that is the decision, we will consider whether any minor changes are possible. I am very aware that as restrictions have eased, perceived anomalies have arisen, and I understand how frustrating those can be, even though there will often be a rational explanation for what might appear to be contradictory. But I can assure members that as part of our ongoing review of the regulations and rules in place, we will consider whether any changes should or could be made to address such issues. More fundamentally, though, we will publish two pieces of work next week to coincide with the outcome of the review that will look ahead, hopefully not too far ahead, to the restoration of a much greater degree of normality. This work will be of interest to everyone, but it will have particular interest for the businesses and sectors, including much of our arts and culture sector, for example, that still face the greatest uncertainty about what the future looks like. So firstly, we will publish a paper setting out what we hope life will look like beyond level zero as we get to the point where we can lift all, or at least virtually all, of the remaining restrictions. This is important because while we have had to pause the route map, we do still, and I want to emphasise this point, we do still hope that vaccination will allow us over this summer to move beyond level zero and back to a much greater degree of normality. And secondly, related to the first, we will also publish the outcome of our review of physical distancing. Now, given the uncertainties of the current situation, in particular the greater transmissibility of the Delta variant, we have taken a bit longer to consider this than we had originally planned. However, I know how important this is for many businesses, in hospitality certainly, but also for theatres and cinemas and the arts more generally, as they all consider how they can operate sustainably over the medium to long term. So in summary, next week, we will, in all probability, although this has to be confirmed after our full review, pause the further easing of restrictions while we press ahead as fast as possible with vaccination, and in particular with double doses of vaccination. But we will also look ahead in more detail to what we still hope will be possible later in the summer. I know the current situation is difficult and frustrating for everyone. We all want to see the back of all restrictions as soon as possible. However, while this setback is not easy and it's not welcome for anyone, it is worth remembering that we are living under far fewer restrictions now than was the case just a few weeks ago. The current situation is not what any of us want, but equally, the current situation is not lockdown as experienced at earlier phases in the pandemic. And vaccination is, with every day that passes, quite literally helping us change the game. On that point, as well as doing all we can as quickly as we can to fully vaccinate the adult population, we are also making preparations for the possible vaccination of 12 to 17-year-olds, should the advice we get from the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation recommend that. I can tell the Chamber that we are also expecting advice from the JCVI in the coming weeks about whether or not booster vaccinations will be needed during this autumn. So plans are also underway to deliver these if necessary. The Government has an obligation, one we take very seriously, to ensure that the vaccination programme is delivered as quickly and as fully as possible. And I give an assurance that we will continue to work with health boards and others to meet that obligation. And despite the difficulties of the current situation, it is vaccination that still offers us real hope for the weeks and months ahead. Getting people vaccinated is first and foremost the responsibility of government. However, it is also one of the ways in which we can all play a part. So I'll end today by highlighting again the three key things that we all need to do to help keep us on the right track overall as we emerge from the pandemic. The first of these is vaccination. Please make sure that you get vaccinated when you're invited to do so, and please make sure you attend for both doses. All of the evidence tells us that that is absolutely crucial. If you need to rearrange an appointment, or if you think you should have had an invitation by now and you want to check up on that, you can go to the vaccination section of the NHS Inform website. If you had your first dose of the vaccine 8 weeks or more ago, check on the website to see if you can bring your second dose appointment forward. From next week, health boards will start to routinely reschedule second doses to bring them into the 8 week cycle rather than the 12 week cycle. Getting vaccinated is in our own best interest. It makes it less likely that we'll become seriously ill from COVID, but it also helps us protect each other. So when it is your turn, please get the jags. Secondly, please get tested regularly. Free lateral flow tests are available through NHS Inform website so that you can take a test twice a week. You can have them sent you in the post, or you can collect them from local and regional test sites. And also now lateral flow devices can be collected from community pharmacies. So if you haven't ordered the test yet, I would strongly encourage you to do so. The more of us who take tests regularly, the more cases we'll find and the more we can break chains of transmission. And of course, if you test positive, please make sure that you self-isolate and get the result confirmed through a PCR test. That is important. If your children are asked to self-isolate by their school, please ensure that they do that. That means staying at home, not just away from school. I know that it is hugely frustrating when that happens, and I want to assure parents that as part of our wider work, we are considering whether and to what extent the requirement for young people to isolate can be significantly reduced in future, particularly as we look ahead to a new school term. But for now, to anyone who is currently helping a child to self-isolate, thank you. I know it is frustrating and hugely disruptive, but it also is an important way at this stage to help keep schools as safe as possible, and of course to keep as many of them open as we head towards the summer holidays. And finally, I'd ask everybody to continue to stick to the rules where you live and follow the public health advice. This is still important. The virus is still out there, and for all the success of the vaccination programme, it is still resulting in hospitalisation for some people, and of course, long COVID is still a risk. So please meet outdoors as much as possible. No environment is ever entirely risk-free, but meeting people outdoors, we know, poses much less risk than meeting indoors. But if you are meeting people indoors, please stick to the limits and make sure the room is as well ventilated as possible. That obviously includes if you are meeting indoors to watch the football over the next few weeks. And please continue to follow advice on distancing, hand washing and face coverings. So in summary, we continue to ask everybody to get tested, to get vaccinated when you're asked to do so, and continue to follow the public health guidance. If we all do that, it is not easy. It is tiresome for everybody. But if we all do that, we will help to get things back under control while the vaccination programme continues to do its work. And that will help keep ourselves and each other safe. And I hope, really hope, that notwithstanding the current frustrations, it will allow us to move to much greater normality with far fewer restrictions as we go further into this summer.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement, and I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who would like to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. People all over the country will be frustrated at the news that restrictions may continue for weeks or even months. We had all hoped for a summer of freedom, but instead this stubborn virus is determined to keep us scunnered instead, because we're all thoroughly fed up with COVID and the damaging consequences it's having on jobs, on businesses, on people's mental and physical health. But the vaccine remains our best hope of beating COVID. Our NHS, our volunteers, our armed forces are already pulling off incredible feats to vaccinate the numbers the First Minister has outlined. And we need to target as many resources as possible in their direction to ensure the vaccine wins the race against the virus. So firstly, can I ask the First Minister, when is the government projecting that all adults will have received both doses of the vaccine? Secondly, this ongoing uncertainty is crippling to businesses, especially those who still don't know when they'll be able to fully reopen. And it's also so hurtful for people planning major life events who still don't know if they'll be able to have more than 50 people at their wedding. So just as I asked the First Minister last week, will she consider lifting the capacity constraints on weddings, especially in areas in level two? Yesterday, the National Clinical Director suggested that this new variant could delay lockdown exit by up to 10 weeks. Can the First Minister tell us, is the government seriously considering delaying the move to level zero until September? And finally, but crucially, figures published today by Cancer Research show a ticking time bomb in cancer care. Around 4,000 fewer people have started cancer treatment, and 1,000 fewer have commenced breast cancer treatment alone. These figures must set alarm bells ringing. The cancer care crisis will continue to spiral without urgent action. So when will the First Minister publish a catch-up plan for cancer care, and will she consider our proposals for a clinician-led NHS remobilisation task force to bring treatment times under control?
First Minister.
Well, I would ask members and those watching to pay attention to what I've said. I think the situation we are in just now is frustrating enough for people, and it's difficult enough for people, for everybody watching, without inadvertently, I'm sure, sort of putting words in my mouth that I didn't use. So I didn't say at any point today, and this is relevant to Douglas Ross's question about September as well, at no point today did I say I thought restrictions would be in place for a period of further months. I didn't say that. I have tried all along not to commit to firm dates way into the future that nobody can be certain can be delivered. I got real criticism earlier this year for not saying the 21st of June would be Freedom Day, because I didn't think it was responsible to do that. So I'm not going to give false guarantees, but equally it's important not to suggest that I've said something that I haven't. What I've said, firstly today, is that we're not lifting any restrictions this week, that it is likely, although we have to go through the proper process of arriving at that, that next week we will pause further easing for a further 3-week period in order to allow more people to be vaccinated. And then I do hope that that will allow us, through greater vaccination, to lift restrictions and not just get to level zero, but I hope beyond level zero later this summer. Can I stand here and give a 100% guarantee of that? No, I can't, because this is an unpredictable virus that is behaving in at times in unpredictable ways. But that is what we are working towards. And we know through vaccination that is the best route to get there. So these situations are difficult enough without any of us trying to suggest that I have said something that I haven't said. And I think it's important to understand that. On vaccination, we have set, of course, the target to give everybody, offer everybody a first dose, everybody in the adult population a first dose by the end of July. In actual fact, by the end of next week, everybody in the adult population will have been offered their appointment for the first dose. In fact, many in the 18 to 29-year-old age group will be getting those appointments by text and by email already, but letters to the remainder will go out over the course of next week. So appointments will be scheduled for the entirety of the adult population that haven't already had their first dose by the end of next week. And then, of course, second doses we are seeking to do within 8 weeks now of the first dose. So you can work from that what the outer limit is in terms of seeking to get the adult population vaccinated with a second dose. Obviously, supplies remain our biggest constraint, so all of that is subject to sufficient supplies, but we are doing that as quickly as supplies allow. On weddings, I said we will look next week at whether there are any changes we can make, albeit that we may be staying within the same levels. I understand, absolutely understand the heartbreak for people wanting to get married, planning and having to reschedule weddings. So we will look to see what flexibility we can give within the clinical advice that we are setting. And I'll say as much around that next week as is possible. And finally, on NHS care remobilisation generally, but cancer in particular, the Health Secretary will set out the remobilisation for the health plan. We committed to doing that within the first 100 days of our administration. Cancer, many cancer procedures, of course, were amongst those that kept going during the pandemic, giving the urgency, but we know there are some people who will not have come forward with concerns about symptoms. So we need to get that back on track. And my final point, Presiding Officer, is that one of the reasons that we need to be cautious right now is that when we talked at an earlier stage of the pandemic about not overwhelming the NHS, we assumed then that almost the entire capacity of the NHS was available for COVID. We don't want to get anywhere near that right now because we want our NHS to be getting on with the non-COVID treatments, catching up on the backlogs and getting treatment back to normal. So that's a really important factor as we try to take the decisions that we face over the next couple of weeks.
I call Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the First Minister for her advance sight of her statement and, like her, extend my condolences to the two families who have lost a loved one and all those who have suffered a loss throughout this pandemic. In order to maintain public trust and confidence, we need consistent communications, consistent decision-making, adequate support for businesses and employees, alongside a robust vaccination programme and hotspot protocols. I accept what the First Minister just said around the 3-week delay or 8-week delay in terms of speculation, but there have been mixed messages that I think do not help maintain that public trust. We've also seen inconsistent decision-making. Why is it okay to have 3,000 fans, for example, at a fan zone, but parents can't attend a nursery graduation outdoors? I agree with the First Minister on the need to extend furlough, but does she also accept that we need much more significant business support, particularly in those areas with further restrictions and better communications with individual sectors? If we do have a 3-week delay from June 28th, that takes us to July 19th. Can we have a commitment that we will have next to all 40-pluses double-dosed by that date and every 18-year-old single-dosed by that date so we can truly ramp up our vaccination programme? Will she publish the hotspot protocols that were promised just a couple of weeks ago? And does she accept that ultimately we will have to learn to live with this virus and that the plans that she will publish next week will include how we can live with the virus as safely as possible?
First Minister.
Well, let me try and take those as briefly as possible in turn, if I can read my own handwriting with my glasses on for a second. I'll do my best, as I have done all along, to communicate as clearly as I can and as regularly as I can with the public in what is, I think, the more we start to ease restrictions, an increasingly complicated environment. I'll say just as an aside that Anna Sarwar's deputy has at regular intervals during this pandemic tried to stop me communicating directly with the public, so perhaps he should maybe have a word with her as well as with me. But moving on, I recognise that as we come out, the easiest communication message in the world is to say to people, don't do anything, don't leave the house. As you try to lift restrictions, there is two things arise. The potential for genuine contradictions that we just get wrong, and we have to be prepared to fix them as we go, and I give an assurance we will seek to do that. But the second thing that arises is for things where there is a rational explanation to appear contradictory. So the example that has been used and, of the fan zone in Glasgow, people are going to watch football over this period. The fan zone provides a relatively safer way for some people to do that, outdoors with lots of physical distancing in a highly regulated environment. On the nursery graduations, I've asked over the course of the last few days the Education Advisory Subgroup to look again at this. Their advice is still to continue with the position, and one of the reasons there is because we know that if there are cases identified in an educational setting, then often it can disrupt the whole setting with many young people and teachers having to isolate, and many early years establishments, of course, run right through the summer. So often there are rational reasons for what appears contradictory, but that does not make it easy for people to understand. So I don't have the magic solution to all of this, but I will do my utmost to try to make sure our decisions are consistent and that we set them out as clearly as possible. And if we get things wrong, that we'll fix that as we go. On the point about on business support, we will continue to give as much business support as we have the wherewithal to give. We are making representations to the UK government around furlough and around further support in other ways, but we will continue to maximise the support we can give within our own resources. On vaccination, we are literally going as fast as supplies allow. If we cannot reach milestones on vaccination, it is only going to be because we don't have the supplies to do that. So I've set out in response to the earlier question, the milestones we're working to, the fact that all Over 18-year-olds will either have had their first dose or the appointment for the first dose by the end of next week. We're then bringing forward second doses, and we will go as fast as supplies allow while planning for extending the vaccination programme into other cohorts. I'll certainly look to publish any protocols the protocol we've published. Sometimes these things are highly technical, but we'll publish what we can to give as much transparency. And finally, Presiding Officer, on living with this virus. I'm always a little bit hesitant to use that language because for some people this virus has meant losing loved ones. This virus will mean long-term health complications. So for those of us who are lucky enough not to have had the virus or not to have close members affected, using language like we just have to learn to live with it can sound to be oversimplifying it. But as we vaccinate more people, and if that link between cases and serious illness continues to weaken and hopefully break, then we go into a fundamentally different way of dealing with this virus, where we have far, far less restrictions, hopefully no meaningful restrictions at all. That's what the paper that I've referred to about living after level zero is designed to look at, and we will publish that next week to coincide with the statement I will make then.
Lorna Slater.
The recent exponential growth of COVID cases in Scotland is a cause for concern, and there is a risk of yet more people dying or suffering from long COVID before their vaccination rollout can be completed. The Scottish Greens have supported a cautious approach throughout the pandemic, and I welcome the decision to delay lifting restrictions today. The travel industry are already advertising and selling holidays, actively encouraging people to travel, even to amber-list countries, for non-essential reasons, not just for family reunions, despite the risk. Will the First Minister accept that if we want to end restrictions in a safe and permanent way, then non-essential international leisure travel will have to be the last thing to return to normal?
First Minister.
I've been very clear all along. It's not been an easy message. It's been particularly difficult for the travel industry and, you know, rightly they have raised questions about this. But I have said all along and I will continue to say that right now people should not travel overseas for non-essential reasons because the biggest risk we face is the importation of new variants. We are living with a new variant right now and that is what is making things so difficult right now. I have spoken in the past, I won't go into more detail right now, about my intense frustration at the lack of more robust controls around the UK border more generally. I think we are paying a price for that right now, if I can be very blunt about it, but we need to continue to be careful and cautious. That's tough. It is likely to be one of the last things to go back completely to normal international travel, but if we continue to be cautious around non-essential travel, and I do know that for many people going overseas is about family reunion, which many people will see as essential, but for non-essential reasons, if we can limit international travel, we give ourselves the best chance of avoiding new variants and getting this current situation back under control.
Thank you. Willie Rennie to be followed by Christine Graham.
Last week, in response to me, the First Minister said she'd look at speeding up the reopening of services for adults with special needs. What was the outcome of that work? Today, universities are seeking early guidance for the return of students in the autumn. When will that government guidance be published? And finally, the First Minister said it is likely that restrictions won't be eased for 5 weeks. I want to explore how certain that is. If hospitalisations don't go out of control and vaccination progresses, will she ease restrictions earlier than those 5 weeks?
First Minister.
I'll ease restrictions as quickly as I think it is safe and responsible to do that. Nobody has any interest in keeping any restriction in place for any longer than is necessary. On the issue with adults with severe learning disabilities or vulnerable adults more general, generally the guidance in place is the guidance that is in place for some time. It does allow local authorities or local partners to open up services as they consider that is safe to do so. There has been communication with the government and local partners to encourage the opening up of those services, and I'll ask the relevant minister to write to Willie Rennie with a full update on the work that has been done there to get those services back to normal as quickly quickly as possible. On international students, we are going to offer vaccination to international students coming this year, which is an additional protection that will be important. And of course, we are working with and will continue to work with universities and colleges to make sure that the right overall guidance is in place as quickly as possible to ensure as much protection as we can for what we know from our experience last year is a risk as we go into the autumn. And we'll keep Parliament updated on all of these things as they develop.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I refer to the delayed publication of the review into physical distancing, which I understand. This is impacting on businesses in my constituencies, such as the Pavilion Cinema, it's family run and owned, and amateur performers such as Pipe and Silver Bands and even a choir, none of which can even rehearse outdoors. Can I ask if particular consideration will be given to both businesses and the performing arts, both amateur and professional, when this review is published? And if I can give some guidance as to when that review into physical distancing might be published?
First Minister.
It will be published a week today, which I said in my original statement to coincide with the statement I will give next week. It will look at physical distancing more fundamentally. So, again, as I said in the statement, that will not be exclusively of interest to the arts and culture sector, but I think it will be of particular interest. And I want to recognise today how difficult this has been for arts venues and how difficult it continues to be, because they are one of the sectors with least certainty about what the future looks at. We had hoped to have published the review on physical distancing before now, but as I hope people will understand, we have been trying to develop an understanding of the degree to which this Delta variant is more infectious, more transmissible. So it didn't seem sensible to publish that while we were still trying to understand that. We will publish it next week. It may not be able to answer every question with 100% certainty, but like the work we will publish on what life looks like after level zero, it will give more of a sense of what kind of environment businesses and individuals will be operating in as we hopefully get back to greater normality.
Megan Gallagher, to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yesterday, I wrote to the First Minister as a final plea on behalf of parents and guardians so they can attend nursery and school graduations and sports days. Parents are understandably frustrated by the growing number of inconsistencies in the current COVID restrictions. Can I ask the First Minister if she will consider the suggestions in my letter, such as outdoor-only events, so that parents can attend these important occasions?
First Minister.
I absolutely recognise how important this issue is, and I really, really do feel for parents who are in the position of not being able to mark the transition in a young person's life in the normal way, and nobody in any way, shape or form underplays the significance of that. I have been looking at this issue, as people would expect, particularly closely over the past week. I have asked, I think I said earlier on, I've asked the advisory group, the sub-group of our advisory committee that looks particularly at education and young people's issues. Their advice still is to restrict gatherings of this nature. This is not the only reason, but one of the reasons is around the protection for educational establishments overall, to try to minimise the potential for whole nurseries or early years establishments having to close. But we look at these things on an ongoing basis. It's important to say, and this will not be of comfort to everybody I know, that nursery graduations have not been cancelled. It is the fact that, and I know many nurseries are looking at different ways to do this. I've heard of nurseries in the last few days that are filming ceremonies and allowing parents to watch online, which is a poor substitute, I know. Others are, you know, having sessions with photographs of children that are provided to parents. Some are arranging staggered pick-up times so that individual parents can see their child get a graduation certificate and take photographs themselves. So there's a lot of thought and care being given to this. I wish we could just take away all of these restrictions, but I have to have mind to the advice that is coming from the experts on this and the reasons for it.
Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you for your statement, First Minister. I wanted to ask what preparations are being made to reassure the international community that COP26, due to take place in Glasgow in November, can be held safely, considering the logistical challenges of the pandemic and the potential emergence of further strains.
First Minister.
Can I thank Michelle Thompson for the first opportunity I've had to welcome Michelle Thompson to the Chamber as she has asked a question. Can I give an assurance that working very closely with the UK Government, with Glasgow City Council, public health bodies and the UN itself to deliver a safe and successful and as far as possible in-person COP26 in November. We recognise there are significant challenges to public health, but there is also, of course, an urgent overriding need to agree action to tackle climate change. All possible COVID security measures are being explored. Vaccination, test and protect will be key. At the G7 summit just a few days ago, the UK announced the provision of vaccines for COP26 delegates otherwise unable to access them, and they've engaged delegates on COVID plans as well. Scottish Government ministers and officials are closely involved in planning for all COP26 COVID measures and all aspects of event delivery. And obviously, as we get closer to the time of COP, we will keep Parliament fully updated on arrangements.
Jackie Bailey, to be followed by Liam Kerr.
My constituent Emma Gilday is being denied the opportunity to see her four-year-old daughter Remy graduate from nursery. A small number of parents and children outdoors in a garden, socially distanced, observing the rules for an event at a nursery to mark the transition to primary school. Not allowed. Attendance at school sports days. Not allowed. 6,000 fans a day at the Euro 2021 fan zone with alcohol and no mandatory testing. But this is allowed. All schools are actually operating full time. So the lack of logic and consistency in the application of the rules is causing confusion and upset. I hear the First Minister saying that the guidelines have been reviewed, but perhaps we could consider inviting parents to test before they go attend one of these events. And will she undertake to publish the evidence which informs any decision about restricting access to nursery graduations and school sports days?
First Minister.
The advisory subgroup what more we can publish to explain the basis of their advice to ministers, and it is their advice that we are going by. If I didn't do that perfectly legitimately, Jackie Bailey would no doubt be questioning that as well. The tone of Jackie Bailey's question, I don't know whether it's intended to suggest that somehow I don't care about all of this. I care deeply about all of this, and you know, nothing, very few things are more upsetting for parents than to miss a milestone in their child's life, and we all understand that. We are trying to get as much back to normal as we possibly can, and we will continue to do that, but we have to do that in line with advice for the reasons I think everybody understands.
Liam Kerr, to be followed by James Dorn.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over the last week, Dundee has seen a surge in cases. Latest figures show 294.7 cases per 100,000 people. This is twice the national average and substantially higher than, for example, Glasgow's 156.5 cases per 100,000. It's also in the top five highest council areas for newly reported positive cases. Now, other areas, like Glasgow, have seen targeted measures, such as walk-in vaccination centres. Dundee operates one centre for those who've gone longer than 12 weeks after first dose. So will this be extended to those who have not been vaccinated at all? And if not, why not?
First Minister.
Well, the local public health teams in Dundee will be deciding on the appropriate response in exactly the same way that the local public health team in Glasgow did that, and they have the support of the Scottish Government for any assistance or resource they need to implement any of that. As I said in my original statement, all health boards from next week, although people can go on already to the NHS Inform website and look to bring second dose appointments forward, but from next week, routinely health boards will be bringing appointments that are on a 12-week cycle forward so that they meet the 8-week cycle as part of our efforts to speed up second dose vaccinations. Local health boards, of course, will use surge testing, walk-in clinics as they think appropriate. And I'm sure the local health teams in Tayside, as local health teams in Glasgow did very effectively a few weeks ago, will keep local members updated on that, and we'll be very happy to answer more detailed questions from them.
James Dornan, to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
So then, thank you, First Minister, for the statement. Day. You mentioned it earlier on in the response to another member, but could you tell us what you think that the UK government's delay in tightening the borders contributed to the Delta variant getting loose in the UK?
First Minister.
There is no doubt, and I don't think I am the only person that will say this, that the lack of very robust border controls in recent months has, I think, been a factor in the situation that we're dealing with right now. And that is deeply frustrating. We are where we are, so we have to, all of us, take our responsibility for navigating our way through this. But if we cast our minds back to mid-February, the Scottish Government decided to insist on mandatory managed quarantine for all direct arrivals into Scotland, regardless of what country they came from. So that would have included India. At that time, despite our pleading, the UK government only insisted on managed quarantine for red-listed countries, and it took until the latter part of April to put India on the red list. I've said many times, people have heard me say it, that that left us with a serious vulnerability of people coming into the UK to English airports and travelling to Scotland and therefore not being caught by our managed quarantine arrangements. We pleaded with the UK government to put common provisions in place across the UK, but we also pleaded with them to introduce a situation where people coming into an English airport but intending to go to Scotland would be made to quarantine at the point of arrival. Michael Gove, I think, wrote to the Transport Secretary back in February, refusing point blank to do that. They wouldn't, and I'm quoting, legally treat people differently in England based on their final destination within the UK. So I do have a deep frustration about this, but we are where we are and we have to deal with this. But there is no doubt at all that two lax border controls around the whole of the UK have played a part in where we are right now.
Pauline McNeill to be followed by Jim Fairley.
First Minister. Why is it that you can have a live band with singing in the Glasgow fan zone in Glasgow, but not at a wedding, in a pub or even outdoors in another music venue? On behalf of musicians in the wedding sector, pubs and clubs, can I ask the First Minister to set out clearly the public barriers to singing and dancing at weddings and in pubs? When can you set out the conditions that would be required to allow this? And would you consider a proposal that I and others from the industry are putting together on the mitigation that the industry could support? Would you engage with this, First Minister? Consider a pilot even that other countries and other cities have done. Give musicians and publicans and weddings hope that there's a roadmap that we can work together on and trust.
First Minister.
I would be very happy to engage, and ministers and clinical advisers will be happy to engage in that. We of course, want to get all parts of economy and society back to as much normality as quickly as possible. There is a very significant difference between things happening outdoors and indoors, and I think people understand that. In terms of outdoors, and this was set out previously when we published one of the updates to the route map, there is a process that organisers can go through to get permission for bigger attendances at events. It's effectively the process that has been gone through for some of the activity around the Euros in Glasgow. These things are difficult. These things demand very close consideration because we have to mitigate as much as possible the risks of transmission as far as possible while recognising the realities of some of the things that we are dealing with. But we will engage on an ongoing basis as we try to get all of this back to normal as quickly as we can.
Jim Fairley to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank the First Minister for her statement today. First Minister has mentioned long COVID several times in this her statement, and I have a constituent who is suffering badly from it. And I'm aware that the Scottish Government is looking at how best to help sufferers of long COVID, and that may well be in the form of clinics once we know what the specialities are that are best suited to the best outcomes. But in the meantime, is there any other support that the Scottish Government can offer sufferers, either practically or financially?
First Minister.
Can I thank Jim Fairley for an important question. I mean, obviously, we feel as if we've been living with COVID forever, but it is only just more than a year. So it is a relatively new illness, and clinicians and experts are still developing their understanding of it, what effect it has on people, so that we can then ensure that people including those with long COVID, get the best possible care and support. The NHS delivers services tailored as far as possible to the individual needs of people experiencing long COVID already. In consultation with clinicians and patients, we've developed support for primary care teams to identify and assess and support people with long COVID. We're also working with Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland to develop their long COVID support service, which complements the work being done by the NHS. We also encourage employers to apply fair work principles to support those with long COVID and make current full use of the furlough scheme. As our understanding of long COVID develops, so too will the services we are able to put in place to support people, and that in time will include specialist services. But this is a process of understanding the impacts and helping people as much as we can as we go along.
Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Presiding Officer, constituents planning essential travel have contacted me regarding delays in processing their COVID vaccination status through the NHS Inform system, causing concern that their travel plans will have to be delayed or cancelled. I'd like to ask the First Minister what steps her government have taken towards developing an app-based vaccination certification scheme, and can she also update me on the progress of the publication of no-show data for COVID vaccination appointments, which on the 1st of June she said she would look into?
First Minister.
I'm sorry. On the essential travel, I think we do tell people that it can take up to 21 days to get a certificate, so they should make sure they apply in good time. I'm not aware of any delays beyond that, but I'm happy to look into that. We, as I said earlier on, we're encouraging people not to travel overseas unless it is essential, but where it is essential, they have the ability to do that. There are still only a small number of countries, I think a relatively small number of countries, asking for proof of vaccination. We are continuing to work in having dialogue with other UK nations about the development of further, more developed solutions to that as we go forward. With my apologies, I didn't quite, probably because I was conferring with the Health Secretary, I didn't quite pick up the last part of the question, but I will check the record and get back. I think it was to do with the technology in place and how we're developing that. So I will get back to the member on that as quickly as possible.
Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Many people have been shielding for a very long time and are now experiencing anxiety as restrictions have eased. Their anxiety levels can only have increased further following yesterday's announcement in England about the lifting of restrictions being halted and that the current COVID levels are possibly to remain in place in Scotland for a further 3 weeks. What advice can the First Minister provide for my constituents who are previously required to shield?
First Minister.
In levels 0 and 1, we ask people at the highest clinical risk to follow the same advice as the rest of the population, of course, to continue to take care. There is extra advice for people living at higher levels of protection, and we continue to review that based on the up-to-date evidence. We've also prioritised adult household members of people on the shielding list for vaccination and encouraged them to take up the offer of free test devices for extra reassurance. Almost 92% of people on the shielding list have now had both doses of the vaccine, and I hope that the protection it offers will make people over time feel less anxious about returning to some form of normality. I am acutely aware of the impact shielding has had on people's mental health and well-being, and we don't intend to ask people to shield in the same highly restrictive way we saw in March 2020.
Dean Lockhart to be followed by Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When the Scottish Government announced its draft guidelines for physical distancing in the hospitality sector in April this year, there was widespread confusion and concern that the measures were impossible to implement and had been published without meaningful consultation with the sector. What consultations has the First Minister had with the hospitality sector this time around in relation to the update to physical distancing to make sure the same mistakes don't happen again?
First Minister.
I think if memory is serving me correctly here, and no doubt I'll be corrected if I'm getting this wrong, when the concerns that the member refers to were raised, some within the industry actually went public to say that those concerns were unfounded and it was a misreading of the guidance, as I recall. I think it possibly was the the Scottish Beer and Pub Society Association, sorry, that did that. We will engage as we go to try to make sure not just that the arrangements we're asking people to follow are in line with clinical advice, but they take account of the practicalities that businesses are operating within. I don't expect in a situation as difficult as this for any guidance or any set of regulations to please everybody, because this is a really difficult situation, but we continue to work hard to make sure we take account of the views that people express.
Siobhan Brown to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank the First Minister for today's update on COVID. I recently had a constituent who had to self-isolate in a hotel for 10 days upon her return to Scotland. My constituent requires a gluten-free diet. Can the Scottish Government confirm that any person entering Scotland who has to self-isolate in a hotel, that the hotel can cater to all dietary requirements?
First Minister.
Yeah, we will absolutely continue to do what we can to ensure that is the case, and we liaise regularly with the quarantine hotels in Scotland to ensure that the dietary needs of individuals are met, wherever that is reasonably practical, and people are asked to notify any allergies or dietary requirements they have in advance. The managed quarantine services contract overall is managed by the UK government, but we will continue to liaise in the way that I've set out to make sure that all of these issues are taken account of.
John Mason to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Thank you. The fan zone and the Euros in general have been mentioned a number of times already. Can the First Minister give any update as to how she feels the first 4 days have gone, especially in relation to COVID?
First Minister.
Well, before I do that, let me say again, as I have done before, I understand why people in some cases we'll be nervous about the fan zone. In other cases, we'll just think it shouldn't be going ahead, given that we are still living under other restrictions. As I said earlier on, we know people are going to watch football. We are trying to provide environments in which that can be done as safely as possible. And the fan zone is a highly regulated environment, outdoors in a big, big space with lots of mitigations in place. So far, behaviour and compliance has been very good. I know the Health Secretary visited it over the weekend. Organisers at Glasgow Life report a good atmosphere on site, a mix of demographics, including families and children. With all mitigations in place, including the testing advice we're giving people, we are confident it is low risk based on public health advice. There has a review team been set up at the initiative of the Health Secretary to make sure that we can take account of any emerging evidence that might change our approach as we go through the tournament. But wherever people are going to watch football right now, it is really important that they follow public health advice. That is true at the fan zone, but that is a big outdoor space. It is particularly true if people are gathering in other people's houses or in pubs, that we take care to make sure that all of the advice is being followed.
Paul Sweeney to be followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank the First Minister for a statement. The First Minister made points about the impact of international travel on the highly transmissible Delta variant and the constraints therein. But has the First Minister considered all provisions within Part 7 of the Public Health, etc. Scotland Act of 2008 and what potential further measures could be introduced, particularly around making it a statutory offence to not comply with quarantine rules and perhaps use that as a means of communicating more effectively to tighten up international transmission into Scotland?
First Minister.
We look at an ongoing basis at all of the possible levers open to us. I'll write to the member specifically around the provisions of the Act that he refers to. I think it is important that we make sure, and we have made sure, so the managed quarantine arrangements that have been in place, although they have been changed along the way since mid-February, the exemptions are very limited and very restrictive, so it's important that we do what we can to make sure any arrangement we have in Scotland is as robust as possible, and we are open to making further changes. That will not take away the vulnerability I spoke about, which is people coming into Scotland via other parts of the UK, and the risk remains that if there is, even if we are applying tighter restrictions here, if there are less tight restrictions elsewhere, then that vulnerability remains. So, you know, maybe counterintuitively, as some people would think, for me, I have been an advocate of four nations' consistency around travel rules as far as possible, and will continue to make that argument as well.
Gillian Martin to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Concerns have been raised that the UK government's plan to phase out the furlough scheme, which the First Minister mentioned, from the 1st of July, despite the fact that we're still in restrictions. Does the First Minister agree that the UK government must urgently rethink these plans and extend the furlough scheme until COVID restrictions are fully lifted?
First Minister.
Well, we've consistently made the case, along with others, it's fair to say, that the furlough scheme should remain in place for as long as it's needed. We've also asked the UK government to review the rules that will require contributions to the cost of the scheme from July, and that currently exclude people who've started a new job since the 2nd of March from being furloughed. It must also be clear to businesses and workers well in advance of the scheme ending what further assistance will be in place to support jobs and necessary labour market transitions in sectors that are most deeply affected by COVID. But given the Prime Minister's announcement yesterday and the situation all of us across the UK are dealing with, I think the case for the need to extend furlough further is really strong and is getting stronger all the time.
Stuart McMillan to be followed by Jamie Halcrow-Johnston.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, the UK Government needs to boost funding for the economy with a major fiscal stimulus so that we can actually secure an investment-led recovery from this pandemic. Can the First Minister provide an update as to the Scottish Government's latest engagement with the UK Government regarding the funding available to support our recovery?
First Minister.
Well, I think I would hope everybody would agree that the need for fiscal stimulus to support economic recovery is very clear. And I think there is an absolute requirement on the part of the UK government not to go back to the Tory austerity that we saw in recent years. Alongside the finance ministers of Wales and Northern Ireland, our own finance secretary is writing to the Chancellor, setting out the Scottish government's commitment to building on the constructive discussions we had at the recent COVID recovery summit to ensure that we are working together as far as possible to build a sustainable recovery. That includes discussing important matters around clarity about the job retention scheme and the forthcoming UK spending review. If we're going to ensure that Scotland and the whole UK recovers well from the pandemic and builds a sustainable recovery, given where powers currently lie over the economy and finances, we need the Chancellor to take the appropriate decisions to support that for all of us.
And Jamie Halcrow-Johnston.
In April, the First Minister advised visitors to Scotland's islands to voluntarily take two COVID tests prior to travelling. So can the First Minister advise me how the Scottish Government has advertised this advice to travellers, what monitoring has been undertaken by the Scottish Government of compliance, and what information is available on the proportion of visitors taking the recommended testing?
First Minister.
We take every opportunity to, as I have again today, to encourage people to get lateral flow tests. I took every opportunity at regular daily briefings. Again, the Conservatives were very keen to stop me doing these, but I take all opportunities to promote all of the things we're asking the public to do. Well, the Conservatives don't like that, but you know, one minute they're asking me to communicate regularly with people and the next minute they're asking me not to do that. So I'll continue to do my very best there. It is really important, and this is relevant to the discussions around the fan zone, for lateral flow testing to be effective, it depends on people doing it voluntarily and responsibly. And increasingly, I think the pilot events in England will recognise the limitations of mandatory lateral flow tests. Anybody who's done one of these knows that if somebody really, really wants to, and this will be a tiny minority, they can generate a negative text or email just by opening the test and putting the barcode in. So it depends on people voluntarily, responsibly doing this, which the vast majority of people are doing. And that's why we continue to promote it. And I will continue to promote that and other matters as regularly and as vociferously as I possibly can, notwithstanding the irritation that causes to our Conservative colleagues.
Thank you. That concludes the COVID-19 update. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business.